Warning, chlorine gas is toxic. P-chlorobenzyl chloride is a lacrimator and carcinogenic. This experiment must be performed outside or in a fume hood. Greetings fellow nerds. In this video we're going to make P-chlorobenzyl chloride, also known as 4-chlorobenzyl chloride. This is the next step in making the antiprotozoal drug pyrimethamine after we made the perichlorotoluene in a previous video. So let's get started. First, we have our sample of perichlorotoluene in the Erlenmeyer flask. I've got about 61 grams. We're going to boil that until it refluxes. Now over here is our chlorine generator and drying flask. Now I've already shown how to make these and what chemicals to use in another video, so I won't discuss it here. Suffice to say, this generator is loaded with enough chemicals to produce 1 mole equivalent to p-chlorotoluene of diatomic chlorine gas. Now after the gas is dried by the sulfuric acid, it passes up here and down this condenser column to the Claisen adapter. There it will meet the perichlorotoluene vapor that's boiling up from the Erlenmeyer flask. Once the two gases are mixed, the fun part happens over here when it passes over the ultraviolet light emitting diode chip, or UV lead chip. These leads are pretty easy to get online, and I'm using a 50 watt version that I've clipped to this spare Intel CPU heatsink I happen to have. It's being powered by a power supply off camera. The wavelength is about 400 nanometers. Now the UV light initiates the reaction between the gases and the heavier products will condense in this exit column and drip back down into the boiling flask. The lighter byproducts will not condense and exit at the top. So let's begin. I'm going to put some aluminum foil around the flask to insulate it so it boils easier. I'm also going to put some foil on the inlet column to protect it from the UV light. To be honest, this was a useless move, so don't bother when you do your reaction. Anyway, turn on the heating, the cooling water, and wait until the p-chlorotoluene starts to reflux. Now turn on the UV light and start generating the chlorine, admitting it to the reaction. Now I have to apologize at this point for the excessive and annoying number of flies you're going to see around the apparatus. They seem to be attracted to the UV light and clustering around it. I know it makes my lab look like a terrible third world ghetto with them in the video like that. Totally unprofessional and amateurish. Okay, moving on. What's happening is the ultraviolet light is initiating free radical chlorination. The light breaks up the chlorine into chlorine radicals. These chlorine radicals attack the methyl group on the p-chlorotoluene to form p-chlorobenzyl chloride as well as hydrogen chloride. The hydrogen chloride gas escapes out the top of the column, but the high boiling p-chlorobenzyl chloride condenses and drips down into the flask. Since it has a higher boiling point than p-chlorotoluene, it should stay in the flask and never get chlorinated. Now what's interesting about this reaction is that it only chlorinates the methyl group, not the ring. In contrast, when we were making chlorotoluenes, we also used chlorine gas, but by using an iron chloride catalyst rather than UV light, we chlorinated just the ring. This demonstrates the importance of selecting the right reaction conditions to influence the mechanism you want. Now you'll notice the Claisen adapter being filled with black soot. This is because we're having small chlorine fires, and you can see them as tiny little orange flashes. Did you miss it? Let me freeze frame on one of the flashes. That orange streak is a chlorine fire. I'm adding too much chlorine too fast, and that's creating a mixture rich enough to burn. Now all the oxygen has been purged out by the continual reaction, but chlorine itself is a powerful oxidizer, and thus it can support combustion in some instances. The UV light is initiating the reaction. Now for our product, we don't want this to happen, so we'll need to stop it. The process is similar to stopping combustion with a regular fire. We just slow down the rate of chlorine addition to create a mixture too rich in fuel to burn. Here we go. Looks like the burning chlorine has been reduced. Let's see what's happening beneath this foil. All the black soot shows that a good amount of my chemical is burned in there. Now looking back, this apparatus was badly designed. I would have had much better performance if I used a long glass tube and led the chlorine deep into the flask first rather than through the top of the Claisen adapter. I would have had better mixing and less burning. Ah well, this is my first ever photochemically initiated free radical chlorination reaction. I had to make a mistake somewhere. At least now I know what to do better next time. Okay, the reaction looks stable. I'm gonna skip ahead until I use up all the chlorine. And here we are. The reaction is finished and I've allowed to cool. The flask should now contain perichlorobenzyl chloride as well as unreacted perichlorotoluene, as well as any decomposition products from the burning we saw earlier. Now rearrange the apparatus and set up for fractional distillation. Our target para-benzyl chloride has a boiling point between 216 and 222 Celsius, so discard everything below 200 degrees Celsius. Then start collecting the fractions between 200 and 230 Celsius. You may have to insulate your apparatus with foil since 200 Celsius and greater tends to be difficult for simple hot plates and bare equipment. And there we have it, perachlorobenzyl chloride. Here is the NMR spectrum proving we have a relatively pure product. My yield was 50 grams or about 65%. I think if I just slowed down the chlorine addition to prevent burning and better mix the chlorine, I would have better yield. Ah well, for a first time that was still a great success. This is yet another step in making pure methamine. In an upcoming video, I'll try and add a nitrile group using cyanide. Thanks for watching!